Thank you for the introduction, and thank you for having assembled here in such great numbers. And I hope that I can meet this, the subject which was defined for me, or I'd rather define it without thinking into what trouble I'm getting, by saying theater as a means of resistance against oppression and genocide. It all has to do for me with the writing of the three parts of the Ghetto triptych, which consists of Ghetto, Adam, and Underground. These are the titles of the three plays. And I'll try to describe the events that brought me to write those plays. Since in my biography I had personally nothing to do with the Holocaust, my parents, my father's family came to Israel in 1922 from the Ukraine, which means long before the rise of Nazis to power in Germany. And my mother's family arrived in the country in 1934 from Poland, again shortly after the Hitler took over the power in Germany, but before anybody could imagine what it was going to mean for the Jewish European communities or the Jewish European people. So I could say that my family saved, Zionism somehow saved their lives. My father's family, they were Zionists, and when they were beginning pogroms were taking place in the south of Russia as following the communist revolution, and when the white army retreated southwards, on the way Denikin and Petlura, these guys were carrying out pogroms, and my father's family, my father was at that time 11 years old, they decided that this is the end of Europe for them, and they took a ship from Constanza to the port of Jaffa at the time, and came to Israel, as I said. So I was born in 1939 in a small village in the Sharon Valley, which is the center of the country. Whoever was in Israel knows what is the Sharon Valley. It was a very fertile part of the land of Israel, mostly growing oranges and all kinds of citrus fruits, like grapefruits and so on, and pomelos and so on. My father was an agronomist, so he worked in the orange plantations in the village where I was born. The village is Tel Mond. Alfred Mond, or Lord Melchett, was an English-Jewish lord, a Zionist, who bought some 1,000 dunams of earth in the Sharon Valley at the time, and planted those 1,000 dunams of oranges, and my village was living on working in the orange plantations and on collecting the crops and so on and so forth. So I had nothing to do personally, as I said before, with the Holocaust. But when I was, I think, 10 years old or so, in 1940, even before, when the war ended in 1945, 46, children, orphans, came to our village from Poland and from Lithuania, and it was the first time that we had to integrate in our school those fatherless, motherless children who were adopted by families in our village and in the villages in the neighborhood. And it was the first time that we Sabras met children who were Holocaust survivors, and who brought with them another kind of feeling, existence, mentality, whatever. They were integrated in our society of the children and so on. And well, we grew up together. We knew approximately what brought them out, but we never learned the details. As children, we were not really very curious to know why they are, why these guys were orphans and so on. I must say that the system of education in Israel didn't make the Holocaust a very palatable subject of studies for us Sabras. And we all grew up, I mean, my generation, with a certain distance and a certain, I would say, lack of interest in what took place in Europe during the Second World War. Every time, every year, there were celebrations of the armed resistance to the Nazis, the partisans, and so on. But because Israel, as you know, grew out of the War of Independence and we had our own wars, then even the acts of the partisans and the resistance movement in the ghettos, like in Warsaw or in other ghettos, was not really at the center of our interest. And when I started to write, I never thought that I was going to write anything having to do with the Holocaust. What happened is that at a certain point, someone who worked in the educational television contacted me and proposed that I write a short script about the youth movements in the ghettos during the Holocaust. And I said, leave me alone, I'm not interested in the subject, I don't want to write about it, it's not my, I don't know even what to say about it. He said, well, here are a few books, try to read them and see if something inspires you to start to write a scenario or something for a short film, some 20 or 50, 15 or 20 minutes. So I said, okay. I look into it and I started to read a book by an ex-partisan of the Vilna Ghetto by the name of Rozhka Korchak. Her book, the title of her book was Flames in the Ashes. And reading the book, all of a sudden I bump into a footnote that the resistance movement in the ghetto, the partisan movement in the ghetto of Vilna, was opposed to the founding of a theater in the ghetto. And that they were, they wrote on the walls of the buildings in the ghetto the slogan, don't play theater in a graveyard. So this interested me because I was already deep into writing plays and working in the theater. And you know, when you work in the theater, you always ask yourself, what is the value of theater? What is the meaning of theater? Is theater still relevant to anything? Or is theater a redundant form of dramatic art that is dying out and its place is being taken by film, by television, by all these things? And is theater meaningful at all? So when I read that footnote in the book, in Rozhka Korchak's book, I said to myself, well, I never knew that there was a theater functioning in a ghetto like the Vilna ghetto. I heard about Theresienstadt, which was a kind of showcase ghetto, which the Germans organized in order to show how nice they treat the Jews and that they even allow them to do artistic work and so on. And this was part of Nazi propaganda, but that there was a theater in the Vilna ghetto, this is something which I was surprised to discover through that footnote. So I started to look for material about that theater, and then looking for material meant in Israel at that time trying to find out to find and to meet survivors from the Vilna ghetto. And I was lucky to meet a person from the Vilna ghetto and a survivor of the ghetto in Haifa who said to me, if you're interested in the story of the theater in the ghetto, you should read Hermann Krug's diary. I didn't know who was Hermann Krug. I didn't know about his diary. I said, I tried to find the diary and I very quickly discovered that it was not translated into any other language except Yiddish, in which it was written. And I was lucky to be able to read Yiddish because thanks to my grandmother, who insisted on talking Yiddish to me when I was a kid, a young baby, and I grew up with Yiddish and Hebrew at home. And she insisted also on teaching me to read and write Yiddish. Funny enough, she used to receive at the time in the 40s a newspaper, a Yiddish newspaper that our relatives sent to her from New York. It was called Der Amerikaner. And I read that newspaper, Der Amerikaner, and what I liked most of all in that newspaper was a section which was called Witzen was Blitzen. Whoever knows Yiddish should understand what it means. It means jokes that are blitzen, thundering or lightning or so. Anyway, I grew up with Yiddish, besides the Hebrew, which was my mother language. So I started to look for Hermann Krug's diary, and I found out that it was published by the Ivo Institute in New York. The Ivo Institute, whoever is interested in Yiddish culture knows what it is. It's the Yiddish Wissenschaftlicher Institut, which means the Yiddish scientific scholarly institute. I wrote to them and I asked if they could send me the diary, Hermann Krug's diary. I received it by the post. At the time, the post functioned still. It was in the beginning of the 80s. And I got the book and started to read it, and it revolutionized my vision of what life in the ghetto, in the Vilna ghetto, looked like. Because Krug made a point of making entries into his diary every day, and sometimes two or three times a day, and recording exactly what was the source of his information, whoever brought it to him, and when it was given over to him, and so on and so forth. So Krug's diary reads like almost a collection of an excellent newspaper, as if it was a newspaper that came out in the ghetto. And among other things, I found out that Krug, who was a Bundist, those of you who know what's the Bund, I don't know if many know, the Bund was a socialist revolutionary Yiddish Jewish party that their ideology consisted in participating in that the Jewish proletariat should participate in the revolution in European countries, and once socialism constituted there, the Jews should demand cultural autonomy for the Yiddish culture. This was the ideology of the Bund, and by the way, my grandmother, she was an ex-Bundist, so this was also, this explains why she was so adamant about teaching me Yiddish and me learning Yiddish. Anyway, Krug's diary, yeah, as I said, everything that happened in the Vilna ghetto was written down and recorded by him in the diary. Among other things, the constitution of the founding of the theater, to which he was opposed at the time. I wanted to find more about survivors of that theater, and at a certain point, there was a book published by an Israeli survivor of the Vilna ghetto. Her name was Irena Luski. She was a 17-year-old girl at the times of the ghetto. And she wrote a book about her memories from the ghetto. I contacted her and I asked her if she knew, if she could tell me anything about the theater in the ghetto. And what she told me is that I should, or she recommended to me to meet the artistic director of the theater, Israel Segal, who, according to her, was still alive and living in Tel Aviv. So I rushed to the telephone directory. At the time, it was better than Google, or Google wasn't there at all. So you used the telephone directory in order to find out about people. And I found out that Israel Segal, theater director, was living not far away from my place in Tel Aviv. I called him and told him that I was interested in the story of the theater. And he invited me to his place. I met at that time a 72-year-old man who was suffering of Parkinson. He was sitting in his wheelchair. And we started, I started to interview him. And we had a long series of talks, interviews about the theater. And what he told me was that, and I found out also by crossing it with the information coming from Crook's diary, that the head of the Vilna ghetto, a man by the name of Jacob Gens, who was first the commander of the Jewish police in the ghetto, but later became official head of the ghetto, who was an ex-officer of the Lithuanian army, tried to understand the logic of the German policy of exterminating the Jews or carrying out mass murders, which started in Vilna before it started in other places in Lithuania or in Poland. Because Vilna, or Lithuania, that before the war was under Russian control, and the Molotov-Ribbentrop Pact of Non-Aggression signed between Nazi Germany and Soviet Russia made it kept Vilna, Lithuania out of the war until June 1941, when Hitler felt strong enough, believing that he was going to anyway to conquer all Europe. Then he declared war on Soviet Russia, breaking the or annulling the Ribbentrop-Molotov agreement, and the German army invaded Lithuania very quickly and took over Lithuania within a matter of days. And shortly after the German army occupied Vilnius, Vilna, the Germans started with a policy of kidnapping Jews on the streets and taking them to an unknown destiny. And the Jews were not in Vilna, they were the biggest minority. Vilna at the time before the war counted 150,000 inhabitants, out of which some 75,000 were Jews. So, and the rest were either Polish or Lithuanian. So you can imagine the Jews were the biggest biggest minority, or they were the majority of the population in Vilnius. Within 3 or 4 months from June to September 1941, the Nazis reduced the Jewish population in Vilnius from 75,000 to some 30,000. So you can imagine that 40 or 45,000 disappeared. No one knew in the Jewish part of Vilnius where these people were taken to. There were all kinds of rumors, but nothing was clear and obvious. And only now the ghetto was constituted in September 41, which means June, July, August, 4 months after the occupation of Vilnius. These 30,000 people who survived were pushed into 7 small streets, the population of which was Jewish before the war, and the Nazis, the population of these 7 small streets counted 3,000 people. The Germans took them away, transported them again to an unknown destiny, and pushed these 30,000 other Jews of Vilnius who survived the first wave of mass murder into those 7 small streets. So you can imagine what kind of density took place there in these 7 small streets, where they pushed in 30,000 people instead of the 3,000 original inhabitants of these of that part of Vilnius. Now, and then they continued to reduce the population by taking out people from that ghetto to an unknown destination. When by the end of 1941, only 15,000 Jews remained in Vilnius, in the ghetto, only 15,000. And then they stopped the mass liquidation, so to speak. And at that time, I'll not go into details how it happened, but the information reached the ghetto by two women survivors of the mass murders that took place some 8 miles away from Vilnius in the forest, that all the people from all the Jewish people from Lithuania were taken to that place, which was a summer resort in the forest called Ponava, and there they were shot. So it was a very primitive way of, I would say, of carrying out mass murder before they applied the more sophisticated systems of gas chambers and so on, and other forms of mass murder. Gens, the head of the ghetto, he thought what could save the lives of these 15,000 people who stayed in the ghetto. And he came to the conclusion, as an ex-officer of the Lithuanian army, that since Germany was involved in a war, in a very tough war on the Russian front, and they were involved also in a war on the other front in Western Europe, he came to the conclusion that if the Jews of the ghetto of Vilnius will prove to be a productive element, the Germans will need them. And if they will need them, they will stop carrying out these mass murders, because this makes no sense. Because that population in the ghetto, if they become a productive population, they will contribute to the war effort. So he said, we can become an asset for the Germans if we will be a productive ghetto. But how do you take these 15,000 survivors who were the remnants of these 75,000 Jews of Vilnius? So you can imagine how broken these people were and how shocked, in what state of trauma they were, or post-trauma were. How do you make of them a productive population? So Gens believed that the first thing he has to do is to normalize life in the ghetto. Normalized life meant to create a health system, to create an educational system, to create a judiciary in the ghetto, and among other things, to take care to create a cultural life in the ghetto. So for one aspect of this cultural life, he didn't have to bother, because Hermann Krug, whom I mentioned before, the guy who wrote the diary, was a librarian by his vocation, and he took care to open a library in the ghetto, which gave out books. And where the books came from, they came from the houses of the Jews that were driven out of their homes, and everything was plundered. And people, when they went to the ghetto, were pushed to the ghetto, they took with them things, and then they abandoned it on the way to these seven small streets, because they couldn't carry these things with them. And Hermann Krug collected those books and opened the library the next day after the foundation of the ghetto. And after a certain time, he celebrated the giving out of the 100,000th book from the library to readers in the ghetto. So you can imagine what kind of an activity was going on there. When I met Israel Segal, the man who was artistic director of the theater in the ghetto, and I asked him how come that he started the theater in the ghetto, he told me that Gens, who was interested in normalization of the life in the ghetto, and who knew him personally from before the war, told him or gave him an order to start a theater. And Israel Segal said, what am I going to do? How can I start a theater? And Gens said, well, there are actors among these 15,000 survivors. Bring them together, and if you start a theater with them, I can give them work permits, which meant for the people life permits. Because without a work permit, you were liable to be the next candidate for a selection and to be sent away to Ponau to be shot in the ditches there in Ponau. So Israel Segal, I asked him, how did you decide who was an actor and who was not an actor? Well, he said, I didn't care very much. Whoever I could integrate in the company, I took, because I knew that it will save their lives. So he gathered together a group of people, some of them were actors before the war, some other youngsters who were ready to learn acting in the, under these circumstances. And he created a theater, he opened a theater there in the ghetto. They got a place where there were like 315 seats. And what I found out is that they every evening they sold more tickets than this theater could seat. So they were overbooked every evening when they opened the theater. How do I know it? Because I found in the Ivo Institute in New York documents about the ticket sales of the ghetto theater. And everything was documented there. And I found out that when they celebrated the 100th performance of the theater, they noted also that 35,000 tickets were sold for these during these 100 performances of the theater. So if you you make your calculation, you find out that for every performance there was a sale of 350 tickets per performance in a theater that could seat 315 people, which means that they had to add either chairs or people bought standing tickets, I don't know. Anyway, it was overbooked. And when I spoke to survivors of the ghetto and I asked them what it meant to them, the theater, they said to me, well, we were young people at the time. We were employed in forced labor. We were humiliated every day and debased the morale was very, very low. And imagine that after such a hard work, day's labor in forced labor, you came back home to the ghetto, home to that room that was overpopulated, because every room, in every room there were living like three or four families in every room. And they said what the best thing we could do was to put on our best clothes and go to the theater, because this gave us a kind of reminiscence, or it returned our feeling that we are still human beings and we have human values and we have a culture and we have a language, and we can still gather together as a community and enjoy together or participate together in a cultural artistic event. So this is what made me understand how important theater can be in such a situation where you cannot develop any other form almost of creativity. Theater, all you need are the living actors. You need a text and you need a room, and this is it. What else do you need? You need lighting. I asked, and you need costumes. And when I asked Israel Segal, where did you take the costumes from? His answer was very shocking to me. He said, costumes, we were not short of costumes. There were stores of the costumes of the people who were shot in Ponar. And carrying out these executions, the people were forced to undress and their clothes were brought back to the ghetto to be laundered and to be stocked for some for any possible reason. So this was the story with the costumes for the theater. And what I learned from it, and talking to Israel Segal and talking to the survivors of the ghetto, is how meaningful and how important the theater could be for people who live under those terrible circumstances where the very existence is threatened, the very existence is you're reduced almost to animal, to beastly existence. And then the theater under those conditions became one of the powers of resistance to the pre-genocide phase. Because whoever will learn the history of the Nazi project of the genocide of the Jews will see and understand that prior to the physical extermination, there was a what I could call moral extermination, reducing people to the feeling that their life is worth nothing. And once you bring people to the feeling that they are less than animals, it's easy to flock them together and to finish them off. And there won't be much resistance from a population that is reduced to almost nothing, to the feeling that they are less than animals. So under these circumstances, the theater became a tool or a weapon in the resistance to the project of extermination, because again, it preserved and gave the people in the ghetto a feeling that, well, they are not animals, that they are still human beings, that they have a culture, and this culture is productive and creative under those circumstances. That, just to say one thing before we open the, our meeting to questions and answers, is that there were writers, poets, and musicians who functioned in the Vilna ghetto. One of them was Abraham Sutzkever, a poet. Another one was Shmelke Kaczerginski, a poet. There were other songwriters. There were musicians. One of the musicians by the name of Abraham Brodno wrote music to the songs written by Sutzkever and by Kaczerginski and by other poets and songwriters who lived in the ghetto. When I did my research, I found out that the songwriter and poet Shmelke Kaczerginski, after the war, he produced an anthology of some 400 songs written not only in the Vilna ghetto, but many of them in the Vilna ghetto and in other ghettos and camps. And he collected also the musical scores for the songs so that you can reproduce the songs. And when I listened to the songs written in the ghettos, in the Vilna ghetto, and to the music that was composed there, I was astonished to discover how full of life that music was. They didn't write only, so to speak, sad elegies and tragic music, not at all. You find songs that were written to the tunes of tango, of waltz, of foxtrot, and other dances that were at the time fashionable. So you realize that the cultural activity that was going on there was in a way more productive than under normal circumstances, so to speak. And when I spoke to the poet Abraham Sutzkever, who died a few years ago, he told me that he was never as prolific as he was in the time of the ghetto. That at the time of the ghetto he wrote endlessly, and he was urged, so to speak, to write and to produce and to create. What I learned from all that experience of the research that brought me finally to write the play Ghetto was how much that creative activity and cultural activity, and most of all the theatrical activity, meant to the people, and how it helped them, as I said, to survive and even to create a moral resistance to the project of reducing them to the life of animals. Yeah, so this is what brought me to write the play, to write the play Ghetto, where I tried to bring to the stage the activity of the theater in the ghetto, and to revive some of the songs, some of the characters, some of the problems that they had to face in that theater. And among other, the scene that was mentioned here by Abigail, the scene of the insulin dilemma, which was to which the a young doctor in the ghetto had to find an answer, and he didn't know what to do when he found out that the stock of insulin was running out. And it is a historical fact that he gathered together a rabbi and a judge and an elderly doctor, and he asked them for advice, and they all kind of copped out. They didn't want to deal with the problem, and they left him alone with the problem, and he had to find his own answer. I find the testimony about it in a document which he wrote, that doctor by the name of Weinrib, Abrasha Weinrib. And I integrated the scene in my play. And you can imagine my surprise when I got a letter from Sydney, Australia, shortly after the play opened in Israel. And on the envelope, I found his name, Abrasha Weinrib. I opened it, and he wrote a long letter to be written in excellent Hebrew, which he studied, I found out later, in the Gymnasia Tarbut. It was a high school where they taught everything in Hebrew in Vilna before the war. And he wrote to me in the letter, imagine my surprise when I got your play, which friends of mine from Israel sent me, and I found out that I figure in your play as a character. Because in my play, I called him Dr. Weiner. I didn't want to call him Weiner by the name which I found in the document, so I made of him Dr. Weiner. And then after a while, he came to Israel, and we met, we became good friends, and the things he told me about his activity in the hospital of the ghetto made me write the third part of the Ghetto trilogy of the Ghetto Triptych, Underground. We may come to talk to it if this interests you, if some of you will be interested and ask questions about it, but I think I have spoken enough. So now if you have any questions, I would be happy to, if I can answer you.
So I have two questions. First, I'm really curious about the content that was in the theater in Vilna. What stories were being told and like what genre they were in. I'm guessing comedy as a way to cope with the ugly circumstances. That's my first question. And my second question, I'm very curious about your opinion as a non-American theater maker. I'm not sure if you have an American passport, but I know you live in Israel. So under the new administration, a lot of minorities are under attack, and I'm wondering what you think theater's function should be or can be in today's America.
Okay.
Thank you.
Yeah, so answer first your first question about the genres. They have, during the 18 months of the existence of the theater before the entire ghetto was liquidated in September 1943, the theater functioned for 18 months, as I said. They managed to put on the main stage five major productions of plays. Among them, there was one play called Grünefelder, Green Fields. There was The Man Under the Bridge, the Mann unter dem Brick. There was a Strindberg play. There was a David Pinsky play, The Eternal Jew, A Yudia Nitzchi. The fifth play, what was it? I don't remember now to tell you exactly, but as I said, on the main stage they had five dramas, full-scale dramas, which they put on. And they opened in the theater also what they called a small stage or a cabaret stage, which they called Diogenes in Fass. Whoever knows Yiddish here, I don't know if many of you know Yiddish, but Diogenes in Fass means the running around in a barrel. And it was a pun because Diogenes sounds also like Diogenes. And you know the Diogenes, the Greek philosopher, He lived in a barrel. And he used to walk around with a lantern to look for justice in ancient Greece. So they said, well, Diogenes with his lantern was looking for justice. Where can we find justice in the ghetto, which is a barrel, and we are all enclosed in this barrel, and we are like Diogenes, and there is only a Yogenes. Yogenes means running around the almost without a goal, without any reason, like being pushed around and so on. So in that on that small stage, they have put on also some five different cabaret review cabaret programs by very strange names, like Peshe von Reshe. Reshe was a small town near Vilnius, and the Jews of Reshe were driven out of their homes and brought to the Vilna ghetto at a certain point. And Peshe is Pestia, it's a name. Peshe von Reshe, when you write it in Yiddish, it is also like Pesha Miresha, Pesha, whoever knows Hebrew, it's like a crime out of evil. A crime committed out of evil. So they used these names in order to hide from the Germans the subversive meaning of these cabaret reviews. The other, there was another program called Kore Dion und Weizen et Teg. It's also a pun, a play on words. Korn is corn, like in and korn yon means years of corn, and Weizen et Teg and the days of barley. But in Yiddish, when you pronounce it, it's korn yon means very hard times. And Weizen et Teg, woe to the days. Woe to the days. And so they, for this, for that small stage, they wrote sketches, they wrote short satirical numbers, and they wrote songs. And so, as you can imagine, and or you can see, the theatrical activity. Now included serious theater, so to speak, and light stage or light small stage light theater. Yeah, so you can imagine that for them it was very important, first of all, to have both entertainment and to deal with problems of the ghetto. And at a certain point, Gens, Jacob Gens, whom I mentioned before, who ran the ghetto, he made a competition, write a play about life in the ghetto. And people wrote plays. And and Isar Segal told me that like 10 days before the ghetto was liquidated, he was sitting in Gens' office and he was reading those plays who people wrote for the competition about the best play of the ghetto. So this is my answer to your first question. To the second question, well, the United States is a ghetto, as you all know, but it's a very big ghetto. The biggest ghetto in the world. I'm not joking, because the moment you start to enclose people within walls, you create a ghetto mentality. And the ghetto mentality is a mentality of closing yourself off the rest of the world, or being forced to close yourself. The Jews didn't choose it in Vilnius to live in a ghetto, but they were forced into a ghetto. I have the impression that according to the new tendencies that I hear, I'm not totally aware of what's going on here, but I read news here and there. And when I hear that there are some plans about creating walls around the United States, or at least on your southern border, it gives a feeling that that someone is missing the life in a ghetto. So I hope that this will produce a very fertile activity of the theater, as was the activity of the theater in the Vilna ghetto at the time. And I'm not joking, because I think that when you have tendencies of ghettoization, the human spirit revolts and stands up against it. And probably it will create a wave of theatrical creativity or theater that will be theater that will fight against those tendencies of separatism, of exclusivism, of paranoia and hatred of foreigners and so on and so forth. This is what I would expect will happen here in the next couple of years, probably, going against the tendency to isolate the United States from the rest of the world and create this kind of very isolationist policy. Yeah, any other questions? Yes, please.
You mentioned the underdog, and if you were interested, I, as a theater major from Brandeis, and I saw you at Brandeis, by the way, and appreciate all your words. What could you say about that play that you did, or like the section of the play? The ghetto. You said there was a third section that you would talk about.
Underground. Well, what I can say about it is, as I said, the play Ghetto deals with the theater that existed in the ghetto. The second play in the triptych, Adam, deals with or brings to the stage a tragic story that took place in the underground movement in the ghetto when the Gestapo discovered the identity of the commander of the underground in the ghetto and demanded that he be handed over to the Gestapo, threatening the ghetto with total liquidation if he were not delivered into their hands. And so the commanders of the underground gathered together and had to take a decision, to make a decision what to do. And they decided something which is without any antecedent in any other resistance movement. They decided that he should hand himself over to the hands of the Gestapo and save the entire ghetto. And this was happened. This is what happened there. So my second play, Adam, deals with that story and with what happened on that tragic night when the commanders of the underground had to take that decision and how they reached the decision that their leader should give himself over. And the third play, Underground, deals with the story of the underground of the hospital in the ghetto. And it brings again to the stage a story of it all started with Jacob Gens, appointing a young, that young doctor, Weinrib, whom I mentioned before, who was then a 28-year-old young physician, to start a typhus department in the hospital, because they found out that in a neighboring ghetto, when the Germans discovered that there was a typhus epidemic, and they immediately surrounded the hospital and put it on fire, together with the inmates and the personnel and so on, because they didn't want to deal with epidemics. Especially so if these epidemics came from the Jewish population. So when Gens learned about that event, he immediately ordered Dr. Weinrib to open a secret typhus department in the hospital. And Dr. Weinrib told me how, with the help of a young doctoress, they made the whole scheme how to deal with that typhus epidemic. And they decided they will give, when the epidemic will break out, if it breaks out, they will give the patients false diagnosis. And they will teach them the symptoms of those false diagnoses in case that a German physician comes to inspect the department and he'll ask people, what are you suffering of? They will tell him the symptoms of what they were written on their charts in order to conceal the fact that they were dealing with a typhus epidemic. And they managed to hide it from the German. There was a typhus epidemic in the ghetto, broke out. They dealt with it, and there were twice visits of the SS doctors in the hospital who came to check up the that typhus department, which they called the Department for Quick Convalescence. And when they asked what is that department, they said, well, because we want our population to be productive, we transfer the patients from the other departments to this department in order to push their convalescence so quickly as possible, so that they will join the effort, the productive effort of the ghetto. And the Germans bought it, I mean, this story. They managed to fight the typhus epidemic and to release the last patient like 3 weeks before the entire ghetto was liquidated anyway. So this was the story of that third play, Underground. Yeah, please, yes?
I just have a question, actually, too. I'm curious how it was that you broke your whole mind frame when you read about this theater. I mean, what really captivated you, really made you interested with growing up the way you did, and did it change you as a person as well?
Yeah.
I'm really curious.
Oh, yes. Well, first of all, what made me interested in the story of the theater was when I discovered what they did there in that theater. The songs, the music. One evening when I was sitting at my place in Tel Aviv, I got a telephone call from Israel Segal, the man who was artistic director, as I mentioned before. And he said, come to my place if you are free, because the souffleur of the theater is at my place. You know what's the souffleur? You don't know? In the theaters, in times gone by, they used to have a guy who was sitting in a small cabin in front of the stage, and he would prompt the actors, prompter is it called, or whatever? Yeah, if an actor had a blackout and needed the text, he would get it from the prompter who would sit there and tell him the text. So, Sarah Segal said, the prompter of the Vilna Ghetto is at my place. Please come, you can meet him. And I ran immediately because I knew that these guys, the souffleur, the prompters, they knew by heart so many texts of the which the actors forgot already. And I came and I met a man by the name of Pergament, Mr. Pergament. And I talked with him and he told me the story of certain sketches and satirical numbers which they did on the small stage of the ghetto. So what made me interested in this theater is the fact that I discovered what kind of vitality that theater created, and the variety of the themes which they dealt with, and the fact that they were bold enough to deal with their most the hottest problems of the ghetto. So for me, what it was, it gave me a feeling that theater can be very meaningful under these situations, so let alone in a situation in which we live and we enjoy such a freedom and we sometimes don't know what to do with that freedom. So this is what made me write the play Ghetto, and if it changed me, I'm sure it checked me a lot, because after having written this, first of all, after having written Ghetto, I thought I will never deal with that subject again. And then I wrote Adam, and then I wrote Underground. And then I wrote a play, which is called Nice Tony, about a guy who was a bully who killed people with his hands in the Theresienstadt. Also a kind of a Nazi bully. And the subject somehow continued to haunt me. And the play, of which there will be a reading tonight at the 855 Commonwealth Avenue, which is called Love in Dark Times, is a story also which is connected somehow with the Holocaust. And it all began with when we visited, we were touring with the Haifa production of Ghetto. We were touring Germany in 85, and we came to Wiesbaden, and we played the play there in Wiesbaden. And after the show, a guy came and said, I invite the entire company for a dinner. And I said, you know how big our company is? He said, I don't care. Bring them all to a restaurant there. And we went to this restaurant with him and with his wife. And then when everyone was having dinner there, he took me aside and he told me the story of his wife, of which this play, which the reading of which is going to take place tonight here, is inspired. Yeah. So the subject somehow, I would say, haunts me, continues to haunt me. And recently I wrote another play which has to do with some aspects of the aftermath of the Holocaust, a play about the restitution money that Israel received from Germany as a result of the agreement with Western Germany in 1952, which created all hell in Israel at the time, created a national crisis. And so I wrote a play about it not long ago, and it was performed in Stuttgart, in the old theater in Stuttgart last season. It will be performed in Israel, I hope very much. The title of the play is Bloody Money. But this bloody money saved our country, saved the Israeli state at a certain point in the early 50s, when the State of Israel had to absorb or to integrate 700,000 refugees who came from Europe and partly from the Arab countries. And the population of Israel at that time counted barely 600,000 people. So imagine 600,000 people who came out from the War of Independence, who had to integrate 700,000 newcomers, without having money to buy corn for the population or whatever the population needed. So the play Bloody Money deals with the drama that this need to receive the money from the Germans created in the country. And I always find myself haunted with one more subject that has to do with the Holocaust. Did it change my life? It changed my life enormously. First of all, because I was invited to direct Ghetto myself in a few places outside Israel, and the play was created in so many countries and so many times, and somehow the play changed my existence, I would say. Not the only play Ghetto, but the whole dealing with the Holocaust, of course. It changed my perspective on many things. Even on understanding the history of the country and of Israel. So, of course, you this is a subject that once you touch it, you are not free anymore to get rid of it. You cannot. It haunts you probably throughout your life.
I can tell you that Joshua, after spending just now 10 days with him, you can give him a subject and you'll get about 20 plays out of him. He's rather prolific and incredible in his body of work. My name is Guy Ben-Aaron, and I'm the artistic director of Israeli Stage, which had the pleasure of bringing Joshua here for this 2-week long residency. I want to thank Abigail. I want to thank Abigail and the Elie Wiesel Center for hosting Joshua here at Boston University. And here, I'll give you the mic for,
On another topic, can you tell us something about the state of theater in Israel today as you understand it, as you are involved in it, and has it changed in the decades of your work as an Israeli theater and play director and playwright?
I began my career in the theater as a playwright in 1971. And at the time, there was a group of young directors, actors, and playwrights who gathered together in Haifa under the artistic direction of a director by the name of Odet Kotler, and who defined the policy of the theater in terms of we have the duty to create a contemporary, relevant, social and political Israeli theater. This was the idea. And every young playwright at the time was encouraged by the theater, by the Haifa Theater, to deal with the subjects that had to do with social problems or political problems or any other aspect of Israeli life. Until that time, I must say that the Israeli theater was much more busy reproducing productions of plays which were successful in the West End or on Broadway, and some classics here and there. So at the time, there was a group of I could say 6 or 7 young playwrights. I was one of them who wrote Israeli new drama dealing with subjects pertaining to the Israeli society. My first play, for instance, was about old age in Israel, which at that time had to do mostly with survivors of the Holocaust. We didn't have yet Israeli-made old age in 1970, almost not. It was imported new old age with all the problems that go with it. People not knowing the language, being uprooted from their culture, from their life, and so on and so forth. Another play that I wrote had to do with the underprivileged classes in Israeli society, which were called the Second Israel in the 1970s. Other playwrights wrote their plays about such subjects also. There were plays about about army, serving in the army, and all these things. The experience of the Haifa Theater at that point proved that the audience was very interested in Israeli drama dealing with the life, the contemporary life in Israel. So in the 80s, tendency to write and to bring to the stage Israeli drama caught on, almost like fire in the bushes, in other Tel Aviv theaters, and everyone started to commission and to do contemporary Israeli drama. What happened is that the theaters in Israel were at the time subsidized up to 60% or a bit more, developed a big audience of seasonal subscribers. We had in Haifa, in 1987-88, when I was co-artistic director of the theater, we had 32,000 seasonal subscribers. 32,000 in a town that counted some 220,000 inhabitants, which is a huge number, a huge number. The Tel Aviv theaters nowadays, the Camry Theater has some 35,000 subscribers, the Abima, I don't know exactly how many, but also around the 30,000. So you can say that the Israeli audience likes the theater. They go a lot to the theater. And yet, in the last years, what happened with the subsidy for the theaters, it diminished. Now it is up to 30%, 35% of the budget, and the rest the theaters have to provide by themselves. So they became more, I would say, commercially minded, and which is a shame, because then we see again a tendency to reproduce old successful musicals that were successful in the 50s, 60s, and so on, like Funny Girl and so on, you know, without having Barbara Streisand for a star. But anyway, so that tendency has now become more predominant in our theaters. But still, they produce Israeli drama, and we have a growing importance of the fringe scene our theater, not in our theaters, but in Tel Aviv. There are a few fringe venues that are very, very busy. So this is the situation in Israel now in the theater. You can say that when a play is successful in Israel, it can have a run of 200 performances, sometimes 300 performances, and even more. So it seems that Jews in general, and Israelis in particular, are very interested in that form of art. I don't know why, because maybe it has to do with the tendency to argue and to be dramatic and to be emotional, and or just to go out and meet other people. Anyway, this is what I can say about the theaters nowadays in Israel. Yeah.
And one can note a big difference, which is that in the U.S., the average population going to theater is under 5% of the population. In Israel, it's 40% of the population that goes. I see there's two hands, so I would just like to take them both together, and then Yoshua will answer, and then I want to make sure people have time to ask people more, ask folks informally. Do you want to go to the informal part?
Yeah. Sure. Great. Two more questions.
Great. We'll ask them one after another, and then there's
two of them.
One, yeah.
About how you've addressed